our topic for the evening, Ms. Sarita Bhandari.
Good evening, I welcome you to the Indian Constitution Chamber, ladies and gentlemen, once again, and please, the podium is all yours.
A very, very good afternoon to all the lovely ladies here. And thank you for joining me today. Margaret Thatcher said, in politics, if you want something said, say it to a man. If you want something done, say it to a woman. So I am very glad that today I'm talking to women because I know they can make a big difference. Many people, especially ignorant people, want to punish you for speaking the truth, for being correct, for being you. Never apologize for being correct or being years ahead of your time. If you are right and you know it, speak your mind. Even if you are a minority of one, the truth is still the truth. Mahatma Gandhi. So, at the very beginning of this presentation, let me make a disclaimer. I am not here, or my little team here is not against any cellular company. And we are certainly here not to tell you that you have to throw away your cell phones. No. We just want to draw your attention to certain aspects of radiation that we may be overlooking these days. So today's presentation, what I really want you to take home is that long-term overexposure to EMF radiation, that's electromagnetic field radiation, will damage your health. And you must be smarter than your smartphone. Okay? So, how many of the ladies have their cell phones here today? Silly question you asked me, right? Okay. How many of you have two cell phones here? Alright, those who have one cell phone will pay attention. And those who have two cell phones will pay double the attention, okay? Alright, let's just begin with how does a cell phone work? Alright, so you have your cell phone, it is powered by battery. You know, you charge it with electricity. There's a certain technology. And when you dial a couple of numbers, what does it do? It sends out a signal in the air to the nearest antenna. From that antenna goes another signal in the air to another antenna, to another antenna, to another antenna, till they have found the number that you dialed out. So the closest antenna to that phone connects to that phone with another wave in the air. All this is happening in the air. There are waves shooting. When that number has been found and this connection is established, on these waves in the air, your voice will travel back and forth. Okay, so let's just think about this. You dial a number here in Mumbai, and you dial out to your friend who is in a mall in Delhi. You've dialed out in seconds. These waves have shot in the air, gone through antennas, possibly also switching center, some computers, some fiber optics, and reached your friend in Delhi. She's in some mall shopping in Louis Vuitton. But they found her. It's happening in seconds. In seconds. And once this call is established, there is not even a second's, what do you say, delay in the voice traveling. So how fast is all this moving? How fast? It's an amazing technology. It's an amazing technology. It's not to be fooled around with. It's not a toy. Okay. So these waves in the air, how are they created? Man figured out how to make these waves in the air. It's a technology, a tool, powered by electricity or battery, can create waves in the air. What I want you to know is that radio waves, these waves in the air that are being used for cell phones, are closest in range to microwaves. They're closest in range to microwaves. For where did we last hear microwaves? Microwave ovens. Everybody's familiar with those. I'm hoping a lot of you don't have them at home. Do you? You do. You don't use it, okay. But that's it. At least you're familiar with microwave ovens. How does that microwave oven work? There is no fire. And yet, the food in the microwave oven heats up. Now, how is this happening? Again, it's a microwave oven. It's a tool, a technology, running in that little box. It's powered by electricity and it creates waves inside that box, right? And what those waves inside that box do is they make the molecules of your food vibrate faster. As it is, the molecules were vibrating. We all have molecules. Molecules is, let's say, it's the smallest part of any being. So, for an example, this building. So the smallest part of this building would be, say, a brick. So similarly, our bodies, the smallest particle would be a cell. So the molecules of the food, and all of these cells, they vibrate. They will vibrate faster. Let me take you a little more in a flashback to school. If we remember, we learned, so air molecules, the molecules are far away. So if you put even a little, if you irritate them even a little, they will vibrate faster because there's a lot of space. Liquid molecules are a little more packed. That's why liquid is a liquid. It's a little more packed, needs a little more irritation, and then those molecules will vibrate faster. In a solid like this table here, the molecules are very densely packed. There's no place to move. So it'll take a little more of irritation to make them move very fast and create heat in this. So air, because there's a lot of space, will heat up fast, very fast. Liquids will take a little more time, and solids like this will take a lot more time. That's why if you put food into an oven, a microwave oven, the dish will take longer to heat up than the little soft food or the curry that you put inside. Yes? Normally when you use a microwave oven, you will heat the food for what? A minute? 2 minutes? Now what if you heat that food for 2 hours? What if you heated that food for 2 months? And then for 2 years? Okay. When you're sold a microwave oven, there are guidelines on how you can use it. They say when you want to use it, you turn it on, you close the door. You close the door of the microwave oven. You step back from it. Ideally, you step back. Because some of those radio waves travel out of that transparent door in the front. And they don't want that to be in contact with you, come in contact with you. So they tell you to step back. When it goes ding, the food is hot, you actually are supposed to give it a few seconds before all that radio wave activity dies down inside. Then you open the door and then you put your food in. You don't immediately go and yank your hand in, ideally. pregnant women are advised not to use microwave ovens, to stay away. So what I want you to remember is that radio waves used for cell phones are closest in range to microwaves. Okay, so for our phones to work, there's two parts to the story. There's a cell phone and then there's an antenna. Right? You need these two things to make a cell phone work. Let's see, how does a cell phone work? Now, you may be, all of you have your phones in your hands, in your bags, and you're thinking it's sitting there doing nothing. No, it's still working. Every 40, 50 seconds, a signal is going from your phone, if it's on. It is going to the nearest antenna to give attendance. I'm here. Because otherwise, how is that antenna to know which cell phone is sitting where? So every 40, 50 seconds, your phone is connecting to the antenna with an airwave. Boom, goes there, connects. Now if you have Wi-Fi, and if you have Twitter, and you have emails coming down, what's happening? There's more working going on. Yeah? It's coming down, all your notifications are coming, your emails are dropping in. So there's a lot of activity. Tejal here, my assistant, is now going to help us with a little demonstration. It is quite interesting. So we have Miss Doshi's number, and you are going to call her up. So she is going to call up Miss Doshi here. So let's hear that. So she dials out the number. What happens? The airwave goes to the nearest antenna. The antenna figures out, oh, Miss Doshi's right here. And the signal comes back here from the antenna. Okay, we've got music there. So great. What does this mean? This airwave traveled out of this building to reach that antenna. That antenna is maybe 2 buildings away. It has crossed these buildings. It travels through these materials. Yeah. Now, Miss Doshi, I'd like you to sit on your phone. Yeah, just sit on it. Please. Guys, sounds a little funny, but yeah, please stay there. Please try it again. Now, let's see what happens. Okay, let us know in case we can't hear it. Whether it's ringing down there, wowzy, and there was not an inch of air around it. So what has happened? This airway has traveled out and then come back to Mrs. Doshi, and it has traveled possibly through her body, through that chair, to reach her phone. Now we're going to just wrap her cell phone in the aluminium foil that you use for packing your sandwiches for kids at school, which I think we must minimize because aluminium is not a great thing for your food. But so here we're just going to completely pack her phone with the aluminium foil, and Tejal is again going to try her and see if she can get through. Alright, so again, she has dialed out. The airway is on there. Is it? Ringing? Is it ringing? It isn't ringing. What does it say? It's something. Oh, I think we need to put a little more oil on that. Yeah, please. So some of the air is still able to get in. We just sort of pack the aluminium in a way that the air can't quite get in. Okay, now it's just completely packed with aluminium foil. That's all that's happened. We're just trying to minimize, not minimize, we're trying to cut out the contact with air or atmosphere. We're just trying to block it completely. let's see what happens. So it is saying that the phone is unavailable right now. And all we've done is just put it in aluminium foil completely. That's it. So what does this show? The airwave went there, the airwave is now trying to find her, locate her phone, but it cannot. Because metal reflects that airwave back. It can't get through to the phone. So what I just want you to remember is, these waves are traveling through buildings, through bodies, through all this soft material. Through water, it absorbs, it goes past. But metal, it reflects. It's very much like light. Okay, so now, the other part to this story is the antenna. So let's see what the antenna looks like. In our country, the antennas look like this. I just came from Japan, and there were like two, three antennas among some 10 buildings. But in our place, you know, in our country, there's clusters in lots of places. And I'm sure you're familiar with this visual. Let's see what a single antenna is like. This is a single antenna. It's a tube-like structure there. Oh, let me this will point. Okay, this way. Which way? Okay. The tube-like structure over there is the antenna. And if the tube, imagine that I am that tube. Now, whoever in front of me is where there is maximum radiation. All these airwaves are maximum in front of the tube. So you in front of me, you would be like exposed to a lot of radiation. But on the sides, it will be less. Above and below also, there will be less radiation. As you move away from the antenna, the radiation will decrease with the distance. So intense in front and close to an antenna. And as you go away from it, there will be less and less. Can we just see the radiation pattern? So that's supposedly an antenna there. So intense radiation here, very high, medium, low. So it keeps decreasing with the distance. There is also some radiation just behind the antenna. So that's why I wonder when, you know, people have antennas just outside their windows, and if there is no metal sheet behind it to block what's going on, I sometimes wonder what is the effect on the people who are being exposed to it, who are living just behind that antenna. So as you see above and below the antenna, there will be little radiation, but intensely here in front of it. Okay. If you want to increase the radiation, you just have to increase the power output from this antenna, and this whole thing will increase. Which is what happens when there are peak hours of traffic, there are peak hours of calls. And during those times, companies need to ramp up the absorbing power of these antennas. So they increase the power output so that more calls can be handled. Antennas have to work 24/7. They have to work morning, night, noon, all the time. Because you might wake up at 3 a.m. and say, gosh, where's my husband gone? He hasn't come. The company wants to keep you happy. So these antennas are working all the time. Now, as you know, the best of things are not good for you if you're having them all the time. Everything in moderation is great. You eat good food. You can eat it in moderation. But ghee, lovely for you, very good for your skin, great lining for your stomach. But if you eat it all day, how would you feel? If you ate it all day for a week, how would you feel? If you ate it all day for a month, gosh, you'd be really ill. Let's take another element, water. Water, essential for your life. I mean, it's the softest thing on earth. Nirmal jal, sheetal jal. But you keep dropping that water on a stone constantly. And what happens? It cuts through stone. So everything in moderation is great, but anything overexposed and there is not good things. Okay, so what happens to people who are living in front of or beside antennas which are working all the time? Apparently, things start small. They always do. With things like, it'll probably be headaches, anxiety, loss of sleep, concentration, and you will not realize what may be causing it. It could be your cell phones, it could be your Wi-Fi. So you just keep it in mind. Just keep it in mind, that's all. Now that we spoke of health, I think it's ideally here, don't take my word for it, I'm nobody, I'm just an actress. But there are people who are much more qualified, and I think we must listen to them. Now this first video here is from Dr. Divya Prabhat. We met him quite by chance, and he is an ENT specialist. He's very much in town. Maybe some of you may have consulted him at some time. Let's watch what he had. We just took an impromptu video of him. He said, we just like to record your observations. And this is what we have.
I started believing in this and I actually started seeing patients around. Keeping all the literature aside.
First, and she has it graphically kind of presented. So please take a look. Next thing is about children, how it affects children, how it may be affecting babies, and so on. I can explain it to you, but then again you may say, you know, how are you qualified to say all this? That's why I'd like you to hear it from Dr. Oz.
An entire generation has grown up with technology.
Then you have your Wi-Fi's. You have your laptop, that's on Wi-Fi, you have a Wi-Fi router, you want to, you have Wi-Fi devices in your house, and your house has a cloud of its own, of radio wave energy. Then, right? Then, close to your home, there is an antenna, and that is throwing out some kind of radiation. Then there could be another company over there, which has its own antenna here. And that could then be radiating here. So, there is a lot of overlapping. We don't really know how much of that radio wave energy we are being exposed to all the time. Okay, that's it. World Health Organization initially said, no substantial proof when they were asked about this radio wave effect. In May 2011, they classified electromagnetic fields radiation as possibly carcinogenic, class 2B. We will wait to see where this goes further. Again, I just wanted to give you a lot of thoughts today, and I hope I have. I do want to say that I'm not against any cellular company. I'm not here to tell you throw away your cell phones. I'm just here today to draw your attention to certain aspects of radiation that we may have overlooked. And I'm certainly here to let you know that long-term overexposure to this kind of radiation will damage your health. And I want you to be smarter than your smartphones. So thank you very much for paying so much attention to me. And I'm happy to answer any questions. And also, we will put up a little slide which kind of gives you our Facebook page, our email address, anything at all that I'm not able to cover here for you. Please contact us, and Tejal or myself or Mr. Munshi, we'll get back and we'll try and help. Thank you very much. Thank you for your order, and don't mind, I love you.
Wonderful presentation and lots of thoughts for us to take home. May I now call Madhuri Ma to take the session forward.
Thank you. I'm so glad, Manu.
Madhuriva, that you brought this up, and it's a personal anecdote, personal experience. I think it helps to bring the, you know, to bring about the awareness, because now people will feel free to, you know, I'm rather than even just taking questions, I'm even happy if you would like to share anything like Madhuriva just said.
Driver, the bhajiwala, everybody, and they're using it all the time.
they have no clue what we are talking about. And we need to learn about it and also just make them aware. It may take a while, but we've got to do this. Because this is one issue which I find, you know, there are some issues which are just pertaining to women. They have nothing to do with men. You know, some reproductive thing. Or there's some issues which are urban. The countryside has nothing to do with it. There are some issues which are of the rich, have nothing to do with the poor. This is one issue which is going to affect anybody and everybody. Across from your little child to the elderly, the rich to the poor, the men, the women, everybody. So, I think it's important.
You can't also blame them, because if you don't get
your connection, you're going to take that cell phone company and slam it, write a complaint. They are trying to do their job. If the cell towers are taken away, you don't have connection. So are we prepared for a little less connection, a couple of call drops? Can we deal with that? If we can, then we are on the right path. When you say, you know, I'm very happy to have support because we need that. I'm not as strong as all of us here. One of us is not as strong as all of us. Even if just by, you know, signing in, submitting in, whatever your experience may be. You know, Madhurima, if you could just write us 10 lines about it. It would help when we are writing to government agencies and they say, oh, you 25 people are making a racket about this, but we don't, and because this is a big country, a billion people plus. 500 people making an issue out of this is not enough. When thousands get up and say, no, we are having problems and we don't want this, the government will have to do something. So it has to be a little participation, and that's why I, whenever there is a chance to at least make people aware, I go about trying to do it, because even if you don't stand up and help me in some way, at least you help your families, you help your children, and you tell your friends and your communities about it. As far as helping you with Antaras, I really would like you to please contact us and I'll, you know, help you. I'll try and help you to whatever extent I can. If there is an antenna very close by your home, looking straight at you, then I think there is a little cause for a little action. As in, find out how much radiation. There are people who can come and, you know, check radiation around your house. Get it checked. Know for yourself what may be happening. And then take steps. There are shielding solutions available. If you grow more trees around your house, if you're lucky and you're on the ground floor or the second floor, make sure there are trees surrounding your area because they absorb radiation. I have put tulsi plants around my entire library. I'm hoping because there was a scientific reason for having your tulsi outside your home. It takes away negative energy. And I was lying in my entire library. I'm like, whatever, let me try my best. 30-40 meters away, there are antennas from my children's bedroom. I contacted Mesa and I said, my children's bedroom has to be shielded. I've got wallpapers, I've got curtains, because through the windows, you know, the radiation comes in. I don't want to take that chance, so I've done it. You can follow it, you can try and use these solutions. If you feel there are antennas, so go home, look outside. If something's looking at you, get yourself checked. You just want to be safe rather than sorry. Nothing will happen in 2 months, but 2 years, 5 years, 10 years down the line, you may have problems. So you just want to be careful. As for every day, there are things that you can do. And I think this was one thing I really wanted to share with you, is just some do's and don'ts. Again, I'll keep quiet and let you see a little video by, again, Dr. Ashish Mehta. And he has given you some simple do's and don'ts which will be very, very useful for you. And if we are running out of time,